Hi, everyone. Our work is on rethinking probabilistic models of human behavior in the context of robotic applications. Whether it's quad rotors, autonomous vehicles, or manipulation, when robots interact with humans, they need models of human behavior for both inferring human goals and preferences and predicting what people will do. In such interactions, robots typically assume that human goals or preferences are captured via some reward function R, defined on trajectory xi via features of the trajectory phi, for example, things like distances to obstacles or efficiency. This reward is typically parameterized by theta, which are weights encoding linear trade-offs between the features or even weights in a neural network. In the Boltzmann model, this reward induces a probability distribution over trajectories proportional to their exponentiated reward. This models that people aren't perfectly optimal, but the higher cumulative reward a trajectory has, the exponentially more likely it is. Boltzmann rationality has seen great successes across all previously mentioned domains in both inference and prediction. So although what we focus on is very particular, this model's widespread usage in robotics motivates how fundamental to the science of interaction it is to get it right. But where does it come from? Let's look at Boltzmann's origins, its precursor, Luce's choice axiom. Imagine that you have to choose how to commute. You could either drive or take the train. In your mind, each option has a value. Perhaps you prefer taking the train, so its value is larger than the car's. Luce's axiom simply states that each option will be chosen with probability proportional to its value. If we further assume that each option has some underlying reward, the Luce-Shepard choice rule assigns it a probability exponentially increasing with its reward. Both formulations are pretty simple and intuitive. However, they suffer from a subtle yet fundamental shortcoming. Suppose that you don't have a preference for driving or taking the train. Then naturally, Luce would predict equal probability for both options. Now, if you have to choose between two cars that only differ in their color and the train, Luce predicts equal probabilities once again. Lastly, imagine 100 of the same car and one train. The more cars are available, the less likelihood is assigned to picking the train. That seems wrong. The simple example showcases the fundamental issue with these options, these models, called the duplicates problems. Should the addition of these duplicate cars reduce the other option's probability by that much? Now, what does this have to do with robotics? Do we even have duplicates in robotic tasks? It turns out not quite, but what we have is a lot worse. Let's have a look at a task where we might want to use such a model to infer the human's preferences. Imagine we have a person demonstrating a trajectory to the robot for how they prefer to do manipulation tasks, like carrying a cup. To apply the Boltzmann model, we assume that out of the space of all trajectories, the person prefers some over the others, and that influences their choice. Here's a simplified representation of that on the bottom. Boltzmann, as an extension to Luce-Shepard to continuous spaces, values each trajectory in proportion to its exponentiated reward against the alternatives. Now, in continuous trajectory spaces, which are typical to robotics problems, we don't really have duplicate options, but we have a continuum of options with varying degrees of similarity to each other. Nothing is a duplicate, but everything is more or less similar to everything else. This is why we think that the Boltzmann model is a naive generalization of the Luce axiom to continuous spaces. Our insight is that we need to rethink how to generalize the Luce axiom to trajectory spaces and account for how similarity in the trajectories should influence their probability. With Boltzmann, the likelihood of choosing a trajectory is proportional to its exponentiated reward against the alternatives, with no regards absolutely for how similar to one another these alternatives even are. We propose that we limit errors due to similar selections using our less formula. We introduce a similarity score between features of the trajectories. Thus, each exponentiated reward is divided by the total similarity between the trajectory and its alternatives. Let's now tease out the difference that less makes in a more concrete example. In this grid world, the person is trying to teach a robot to navigate from the orange circle to the cross by providing 10 demonstrations xih. The human's reward trades off between two features, the distance to the two objects. In this situation, the person wants the robot to stay close to both objects. In the second grid, however, the person prefers the robot to stay far away from both of them. For both grids, we can plot the feature density for the distance from the top left object. When we additionally plot the human samples, we see that for the first grid, the demonstrations fall in a dense region because there are many trajectories between the two objects that have similar feature values. Meanwhile, for the second grid, we see that the trajectories fall into sparser areas of the feature density because there are much fewer trajectories that are farthest away from the object. So, why does this lead to Boltzmann being wrong? To see how Boltzmann suffers from the similarity problem, let's attempt to perform inference using these demonstrations. Here's the first grid, with demonstrations falling in the high-density area. When we perform Boltzmann inference to determine which data produce these demonstrations, we see that the posterior probability is high entropy. There is no clear theta being inferred. In this example, Boltzmann inference underlearns because there are many high-reward alternatives, which lowers the probability of the demonstrations. In the second grid, with the 10 demonstrations lying in a low-density area, we see the opposite effect, where Boltzmann inference is extremely confident that the true objective is to stay far away from both obstacles, although some of the trajectories clearly stay close to the second obstacle. It turns out that in this example, Boltzmann inference overlearns, because observing such rare demonstrations seems like some extraordinary occurrence. Even worse, the Boltzmann inference learns much more from these six trajectories that lie in the lowest density area, essentially ignoring the other four trajectories that lie in a slightly denser region. In summary, Boltzmann, by being sensitive to feature densities, can under or overlearn. Now, how does LESS solve this problem? The way it does so is by flattening the curve, regulating the effect that similarity between trajectories has on their probabilities of being chosen. The result is that in the first grid, LESS confidently identifies the ground truth because it doesn't underlearn, whereas in the second grid, LESS doesn't overlearn and recognizes that the trajectories give evidence for two objectives. Armed with this intuition behind our model, we put it to test in a mechanical Turk experiment with real people, grid-world simulations, and a real-world, high-dimensional scenario with a robotic manipulator and real human demonstrations. First, we checked if people chose trajectories based on LESS or on Boltzmann. We ran a mechanical Turk study with 80 people, split into two groups. The task was to teach a robot how to navigate while using the least number of tiles and avoiding the obstacle. In the control group, the participants saw two equally good trajectories, left and right, and one bad one. This gave us control proportions of left versus right trajectories being chosen. In the experimental group, we added two right trajectories, very similar to the original one. Here we show the predicted proportion of left versus right choices using Boltzmann and LESS, respectively, as well as the observed proportion in the experimental trial with a dotted line. Our main observation in this experiment is that the Boltzmann proportion prediction is significantly different from the observed, whereas LESS proportion predictions provided tighter equivalence bounds to the observed. Now, if people do act more like LESS than Boltzmann, how much does this impact the robot's reward inference when using this model? We used the same grid world described previously, and we simulated sampled human demonstrations according to 8 different preferences data. We see that when the person behaves according to LESS, inference quality is significantly higher with LESS than with Boltzmann. This plot suggests that if people are LESS, then it's important to model them as LESS. We lastly performed an experiment with a real-world, high-dimensional scenario with a 7-degree-of-freedom robotic manipulator and real human demonstrations, where one cannot have access to the full trajectory space, nor to the ground truth reward. Returning to our models, we see that in the real world with infinite dimensional trajectory spaces, it is intractable to compute the integrals in the denominators. Thus, in practice, we need to sample the trajectory space to transform the integrals into finite sums. We've previously teased that Boltzmann inference performance is highly dependent on the structure of the environment, specifically on the feature space density induced by all possible trajectories. Now, we hypothesize that different sampling sets will result in vastly varying inference results for Boltzmann, whereas for LESS, there will be more or less robust. To this end, we collected demonstrations from 12 users for 3 robot manipulation tasks, carrying the couple, keeping it close to the table, away from the laptop, and away from the human's body. To test our hypothesis, we sampled 10 different trajectory sets to emulate the continuous and infinite trajectory space. This plot showcases that performance inference with LESS across multiple trajectory sets in a real-world setting results indeed in higher robustness than inference with Boltzmann. Together, our results provide evidence that LESS is a better model for explaining people's choices, performing high-quality inference, as well as robustly inferring prefaces in the real world. Thank you very much.